About a subject that's called Beatchop, because I had a request on my Facebook account. Could you make a video tutorial about Beatchop? Yes, I can. Beatchop, in this current state, is being processed through a audio track right there. The thing that I did was record my own voice and put that right through a Beatchop that is kind of like the as you can hear right there. That's kind of like annoying, I know, but it kind of proves the fact that I can chop up a audio file into smaller segments, and that turns into like a chopped up loop. In a way, you could compare it with this setup that I have right here, because over here you have a thing that's called a Dr. Octorex. Well, Dr. Octorex is like slicing up a loop into smaller segments, and you can play back those whole small segments. Well, that's kind of like the way that Beatchop does it, but it buffers the incoming audio and then chops that up into steps, either lengths, depending on these two right there, steps, the resolution. Those will determine the length of the buffer. If I press this whole segment over here, the only thing that I'm doing right now is triggering one time each time a slice. It's located over here. And the way that this kind of works is that you can use the MIDI keyboard to trigger slices. To prove this point, I'll just go for this route. I have another track over here. Two audio tracks doing nothing. Yeah, they play a sequence like this. There's a basic drum and bass liquid thing. Stick in a creative effect over here, and I'll go for Beatchop right there. And I'll put the steps on 32, because I like that for some reason. It's the length of the buffer, the steps. Create effect, Beatchop. So now I actually have two of them. I'll put them both on 32. As soon as I'm going to press play over here, Beatchop, over here, the only thing that it does right now is it fills up the buffer, but it plays the song in the normal state. By default, I don't find this transition rather useful, because normally if I would want to Beatchop myself, I don't want to have the incoming audio coming through it. Watch this. I'll just take another one right there. I'll just reset this whole thing. Creative effect, Beatchop, slicer, right there. Have them two times, again. The thing that I'm going to do is turn a setting off that's all located over here. That's called the transparent mode. And by default, it will have that thing enabled, which means that it will send out the original track coming inside of the buffer and play that back. But I don't want that. I'll just turn these off right there. And the thing that you're going to notice right now, as soon as I'm going to press play, you hear a really interesting sound. You know what the sound is called like? It's called silence. Yes, it's silence. The reason why this can be handy is if you are like preparing your track more or less, and you want to Beatchop later on, this is the way that you could do it. You press run, and whatever, you don't hear that whole thing. And if I go back to my track over here, go back to my track, say right click and then say create track for Beatchop right there. And then say right click, create track for Beatchop right there. Select the Beatchop track right there, and this thing just keeps on buffering, whatever. I can start pressing keys. On my MIDI keyboard. And every key that I'm triggering is a portion of this buffer. As you can see right here, I hope you can actually see it. As soon as I'm going to press C2 over here, you can see that it lights up over here. And this is kind of like one of the reasons why I like the combination of using audio tracks and then combine that with a matrix pattern step sequencer, for instance. Because if I toggle back to the rear, you will notice over here, you have a note in and a gate in. And because I know that the native note, or the first note that's being used by Beatchop, is C2, I can use that as a reference to make my sequence to work. So the thing that I'm going to, I'll just take a utility, it's going to be a matrix pattern subsequencer, go back to the front, and this thing will run the same sequence as the buffer. Okay, what if I want to create a new drum pattern out of this thing? Let's just do it like this. I'll just go like create a staircase out of this thing. There. Not using Dr. Octorex, using slices, but I'm, well, real-time slicing this thing on the fly. This goes in conjunction with a thing that's called an envelope, right there. If you would kind of compare this with this one, right there, let's take this route. If you take a Rex file, let's go for an aim and break, run this thing, I can drop the amplitude right there, can increase the release, and I can increase the decay. That is amplitude in a nutshell. Well, it's kind of like the same way that this envelope handler over here works like. You have an attack, a decay, a sustain, and release. Can make it really short and snappy if I want to. There. But because I'm using a staircase, which means that it is corresponding with the buffer that I have right there, and the steps are equal, 16, 16, the resolution is equal, 1/16th note, 1/16th note. But however, this allows me to change the way that the buffer needs to be played back. So I can make changes within this matrix pattern step sequencer, go like, make it really funky, and go like this. And I'm not using slices, I'm using a matrix pattern step sequencer. However, you can also change the rate of that buffer status. So it becomes a little bit more glitchy in a way, as you can hear right there. Or you can slow things down, just like this. Put the steps or the resolution on 8 right there. So you can see it like this, is that in this context, it takes 2 slices of the buffer to play back one note. That's kind of like the way it works. But in this context, it will play 2 slices from the buffer on one note. And that is where the glitch factor comes in. There are, however, some cool features within the system, by the way. And that has everything to do with pitch controls and length and, well, turning this into a granule mesh. Let me put it that way. I'll take this loop over here. Put the thing into play. That's our loop. I'll put this transparent mode off, right there. The thing that I'm going to do over here is create a utility that's going to be a matrix pattern step sequencer. I'll just set these two to be equal, right there and right there. And please make note, this is not going to be the most musical part that you're going to hear, because this is just about creating a effect from this Beatchop effect thing. Press run. The thing that I can do right now is change the length of that buffer play mode right there. But I can also crank up the resolution on the steps that I'm triggering over here. So the thing that I'm going to do is crank this thing all the way open to 128 right there. Yeah, stuff like this going on. But I can also change over here the sample start slice right there. And I can change the sample length, opening up the length knob right there. Either change the volume. Well, I'm not going to change the volume yet. But the thing is, I'm going to change the starting point of the buffer. I'm going to change the length, duration of the slice length right there. I can also change the way that this thing plays back. That's loop mode right there. A loop off, forward, or alter. I'll just take forward over here. So in a way you can see it like this, is that mod wheel right there, over here, is now controlling that knob, either that knob. So we're changing the start point and the length. So we'll just go like this. There. In a way, I'm turning this into a kind of more like a glitchy setup. Well, imagine this is that you can alter the pitch. You can do it right here. That's called the pitch speed right there. And this thing kind of sounds weird sometimes, but it also sounds cool weird sometimes. To make somewhat use of multiple segments from the modulation wheel, I would go for the combinator as an audio effect process. So in this case, it's being used as an instant effect, where I have the audio track right there. The thing that I'm going to do is take a combinator patch right there, and I'll take the audio output from this audio track, and I'll take the audio output from here to the combinator right there. That's the direct out. Just going to delete these two devices right here. That's that one, delete. That one, delete. Next thing I am going to do is reduplicate the settings that I had in the previous setup with an instant effect, but I'm going to stick this inside of a combinator. And I will explain later on why I'm doing that. Take a creative effect that's going to be a Beatchop. Take a instrument. A utility that's going to be a matrix pattern step sequencer. Take the steps on 32 because I need a longer buffer and have the resolution all the way open right there. Press run and it should come up with a similar effect right there. Put the transparent knob off so there is no transparency whatsoever. So the only thing that I'm capturing right now is the buffer. I'm playing that back right there. And the next thing I'm going to do over here is say show programmer. And the reason why I'm going to use the combinator instead of using this as an insert effect is because I have the ability over here to control the mod wheel through the combinator and program that individual parameters throughout the whole Beatchop. To make this all work, I'm going to select Beatchop right there. And I'm going to select the modulator that's going to be controlling the speed. And that's going to be the pitch. So I'll just got to find this one. There you are. Pitch speed right there. And I'm going to stick with the zero, around zero value right there. And connect this to the mod wheel right there. It will now control the mod wheel over here. Next thing I will do is take a mod wheel three times right there. That's one, that's two, that's three. And then connect these independently to the length and the start. Slicer start percentage. Percentage, and then I'll take slicers length, and it's going to be percentage, which controls these knobs right there. But in this case, I'm going to do the length the opposite way, so it starts off with 100%, and it goes down to not zero. It's going to be too drastic. Let's take it like 40, 41 or something. Okay, so. So you can imagine this is that I'm not only controlling the way that the length is changing, but it also changes the pitch and it kind of becomes like a granular synth thing. So the thing that I can do is say copy patch and do the same thing on my drum track that I have right there. And say create utility, there's going to be a combinator patch again. And I'll take the direct out from the audio channel and stick that inside of the combinator. Right click, paste patch. Paste patch. There. Let's see what this will do. Take this mute right there. That's our drum loop. That's our drum loop. And I can also change the note. So in this context, I'm creating kind of like really weird sounds from this whole device by using really short notes. And these notes can be altered in the different directions by changing the starting point of the buffer. If I take this release all the way open a little bit, you will have a more subtle transition from one note to another note. But still, I can play around with the pitch and the start point and the length by using this mod wheel right there. So yeah, this is more the creative approach on using Beatchop. Another thing that you could do over here, and that's just going to be the really easy part, is take an arpeggiator right there and stick the arpeggiator inside of Beatchop. Press run right there and then press chords. The only thing that I'm doing right now is I'm pressing a chord and triggering the RPG8 to trigger my drum pattern. Another tricky setup that you could go for is because if you get to alter the resolution, it also changes the pitch of the buffer status. I'm not sure if this is a bug, by the way, but I accidentally figured this one out when trying to fiddle around with certain settings. Take, for instance, over here a maelstrom and connect the maelstrom inside of Rotate 1 and go back to the front panel and say Show Programmer. Take Beatchop over here. And I'll take Rotate 1 and connect this thing to the resolution of the buffer. Where are you at? Buffer. Resolution. Right there. And now things will go a little bit more mental. Yeah, mental. Because that's my shit. Put this thing in sync. Right there. And if you're up to it, could also crank up the rate over here. And you got some random stuff going on. Anyways, hopefully this might shed some light on the subject of Beatchop and how you could use it to chop up loops, either chop up audio tracks, either chop up synths, either chop up anything you like. Anyways, have lots of fun, and I will talk to you later.